My name is Ross Adams, and I'm an application engineer at Markforged. What we're going to be discussing today is the application category of end-of-arm tooling. Now, this is a killer application for 3D printing, and we're going to be discussing the benefits realized when you leverage both composite and metal 3D printing for this application. Let's start with the application category. Now, end-of-arm tooling, it goes by the names of end effectors, grippers, fingers. There's a lot of different names that it goes by, but really it's standing on top of the shoulders of a larger Industry 4.0 technology, robotics. And it's a critical element to integrate the robotic system with the manufacturing cell for high throughput and efficiency. So we have a part to show you today to provide you an example of what end-of-arm tooling looks like. Now, this was designed by a system integrator, and it's used to transport a casting component from one step in the fabrication to sub-assembly. Now, there's a few requirements in order for this tool to be successful. The first one needs to have very high stiffness and strength to ensure that it can provide sufficient clamping force to the part that's gripping. It also has to have high heat resistance because the part that's gripping is going to be heated before it moves it from one step to another. And finally, it needs to be durable. So wear resistance is very important to ensure that this tool can last thousands of cycles to ensure that we hit our return on investment and it made sense to make the tool for this job. So I want to highlight a few design features of this 3D printed approach to the end of arm tooling. Now first, you might notice that this is a hybrid tool, meaning it is printed in both metal and composite 3D printing, as well as some components off the shelf to assemble the two features together. Now, why would you take this approach? Well, in this application, lightweighting is important. And I think you can make that argument for roughly 90% of the applications in the world. But with end effectors, lightweighting is specifically important because that results in a lower payload on the robotic arm, and with less weight, it can actually move quicker and perform its operations faster, which on the bottom line results in higher throughput of that work cell. So with this approach, we have localized the armature with carbon fiber reinforced onyx. And with that, we get the strength and stiffness of 6061 aluminum, but at a fraction of the weight. Additionally, what we see here is some metadata attached to the tool, including the hardware, some orientations, and the part number. And that is integrated into the tool at the design level. Next, I want to talk about these little notches on the tool. Now, these are a mistake-proofing feature that you might not include traditionally, but 3D printing, it's as simple as adding that to the CAD design. And what this does is ensures that the operator is only able to install this tool on the right-hand side and can't put it on the left-hand side. It ensures that there's not going to be unexpected downtime due to the human error of loading the part in. So next, I want to transition to the metal part. Now, recall our requirements. We need heat resistance and wear resistance. And for that reason, we're going to have to turn to a metal, and in this case, H13 tool steel. So the first feature I want to highlight on this metal insert is the knurling features. So knurling is added to parts typically to add sufficient grippage and make it easier to hold parts together, unscrew caps, lots of different areas. So sometimes knurling is relatively easy to add if you want to add to like a rod. It's just a simple operation on the lathe. But for something like this, it requires more sophisticated machinery and tooling, and someone who's highly specialized in the CNC programming to understand how to create this tool path. And with 3D printing, we knock down these barriers to entry with simple slicing software that makes it much easier to go from a CAD design to an actual part. Another cool feature of this part is the small diameter hole. Now, the function of this is for a sensor to get fit into. Now, if you go to a machinist with a hole diameter of 1 mm by 20 mm depth, they're not gonna like you for it, because drilling that small of a diameter into a tool steel has very high likelihood that the drill bit can break, and then it's a massive rework operation. But a 3D printer isn't scared of stuff like this. It actually does, you know, make the part lighter, use less material, and lead to higher performance. Even if this hole is going to require a very tight tolerance for a specific type of slip fit, perhaps, having the pilot hole already printed at near net shape can really help accelerate your time to market and actually get your parts and not spend all this time reworking and scrapping materials and just, you know, going through this learning process. These features are exciting, and they really do a great job of emphasizing the benefits of 3D printing versus some of the constraints of traditional manufacturing. But what about some elements of the design where you can't even machine it? So first I want to start with the infill on the roof of this part. Now, we print our parts with a lattice triangular infill. What that does is reduces the weight of the part, And in 3D printing, the less weight means the lower material cost and the faster print times. So it's practically mostly air inside this part, but we have the strength and the wear resistance on the surface. And once again, lightweighting is critical for this application, and it's a way that you can make parts lightweight much simpler than something that you would do with machining. And finally, I want to talk about the process improvements that were realized from this 3D printed part. Now, the process improvements are where the benefits of 3D printing are most greatly realized, because that leads to a broader scope of areas that the machine has an impact to your business. In this case, recall that the part is picking up a heated component and moving it from fabrication to subassembly. Now, by the time it gets to subassembly, they actually have to let it sit for a couple of minutes to ensure that it's cool enough that the operator can pick it up and install it into the assembly. But what if you could cool the part while it moves from one step to another? And that's something that this designer didn't realize until he started taking this additive approach, and something that now he can take advantage of. Traditionally speaking, that might be difficult to do because there's not a lot of areas here to add coolant fluid. But with 3D printing, we can start rethinking these assumptions that we've always made with traditional manufacturing that lead to better performance. So what we have here is a coolant channel that runs through here between the two screws and out the other side. And we're going to be running a fluid through, so as it picks up the part and moves to the next step, there was actually a 60% reduction in the amount of time it took to cool and when they could be put into the assembly. And this is exciting because you couldn't even do this traditionally, because it's following a contoured pattern. And unless you have a flexible drill bit, which I don't know of any, additive is the only answer to this solution. End of arm tooling is one of my favorite applications because of the high value and low volume, and also high complexity that you can introduce into the process when 3D printing is the fabrication process. I hope this gives you some inspiration into the ways that you can design your end of arm tooling, and maybe some ways that 3D printing can capture some benefits that you might not have even thought of before. Done.